Welcome back to a brand new series, The London Weekend Show. It's 7:30 in the morning. The shipping forecast promises force 8 winds, and we're heading out of Ramsgate Harbour into the North Sea. Our destination officially ceased to exist 10 years ago, but I can tell you that it's still there just by turning on the radio. We're setting our course to track down the last of the pirates.
Going back in time on the sounds of the nation, it's the Caroline Flashback.
Radio Caroline was the first of the pirate radio ships which brought all-day pop music to British listeners in the 60s, and today it is the last. This act, the Marine Etc. Broadcasting Offences Act of 1967, forced all the other pirate radio stations off the air and left the way clear for the new BBC Radio 1 and later the independent local radio stations like Capital. It forced them all off the air except Caroline, alone but still going strong. Stronger than ever, in fact. If you've spun your radio dial lately, you might have noticed a new station between LBC and Radio 4 on the medium wave. Well, that's Caroline, broadcasting with a new and much more powerful transmitter on 319 metres.
So we're sailing out to discover how Caroline managed to survive an act of parliament which scuppered the other buccaneers. We're also hoping to find out more about that act, one clause of which could make it illegal even to wear a Caroline badge on your lapel. So as we sail out into the North Sea, let's take a look at how the pirate story began.
To an audience accustomed to almost a decade of all-day pop radio, the sound of Caroline in the 60s might not appear that revolutionary today. To appreciate the impact it had then, you have to remember that before the pirates sailed over the horizon, listeners had to wait all week until 11 o'clock on Saturday night for this.
Greetings, pop pickers. It's Pick of the Pops.
Pick of the Pops on the Light programme. BBC's only real concession to pop records on the radio.
The lineup today includes Norbert and Eager, the Righteous Brothers, Roy C., Stevie Wonder, the Morgan James Duo, and Gene Latter. Then comes the Mummers and the Poppers.
If you wanted pop at any other time, you could tune in to the evening's only broadcast on Radio Luxembourg.
This is Radio Luxembourg, your station of the stars, broadcasting on 208 metres medium wave.
Although their programmes had a habit of fading away and buzzing with interference just as your favourite record came on. Because of the lack of competition, however, Luxembourg had built up an enormous audience for its pop output by the early 60s. Nobody at Luxembourg in 1964 could have realised how soon their lead was to be challenged. In a small and secluded Irish fishing port called Grenor, two ships were rapidly and secretly being made ready, and on Easter Saturday 1964 at 12 noon...
You're tuned to Radio Caroline on 199, your all-day music station.
Can't buy me love!
A month later, Caroline was joined in the Thames estuary by a rival ship, Radio Atlanta, broadcasting from the Mi Amigo. Shortly afterwards, they joined forces to become Caroline North and South, and the original ship sailed off to a new anchorage off the Isle of Man. The original stations had a variety of respectable city backers, including financier Oliver Smedley, publisher and Lloyd's underwriter Major D.C. Lomax, and Jocelyn Stevens, currently head of Beaverbrook Newspapers, but then editor of Queen magazine. Caroline was, however, very much the creation of one man, Ronan O'Reilly, seen here in 1964, shortly after Caroline had started. In those days, O'Reilly, whose father was a wealthy Irish shipping magnate, was active around the London music scene, managing a club and hustling promising bands. 13 years later, I spoke to him about those early days.
This is what actually started Caroline, right? I record Georgie Fame.
I didn't know anything about the business. I just thought, this guy's fantastic. British public will love him, right? Called him, go to the various record companies, which were two, by the way. It was EMI and Decca, and that was it. And I didn't understand that either. I didn't understand why there weren't 100 record companies. But I understood it in a few minutes, which was when I was sitting in Luxembourg saying to them, which was the only station that had a couple of hours a night coming in, and I said, look, I have an acetate here, but I'm Georgie Fantorific. And they sort of went into hysterical laughter and said, look at the boards, and it was like EMI show, Decca show, EMI and X show. And I got absolutely, I was shattered by the reality that nothing that wasn't EMI or Decca would be played. And even the people at the BBC weren't giving the music thing. I mean, that wasn't considered to be serious. And he kept getting to brick wall. And finally, the only kind of way to kind of get around all of that was to actually have a radio station.
But it couldn't be an ordinary radio station. It had to be a floating radio station.
Basically, the only free place on the planet left is international waters. Now, the reason it is free, the reason man hasn't quite done his usual jackboot number on that place, is that there's a vested interest in keeping international waters free. If you abandon the three-mile limit idea and two nations 20 miles apart get together and say, right, any boats that come through here now, we're going to charge a pound a ton on the, you know, and that's what's kept the sort of, you know, the international water thing free. So after 3 weeks of Caroline, from nothing, we had 7,200,000 listeners, which was phenomenal.
Radio Caroline was a success story from the start, and it was soon joined by a host of offshore imitators.
The original Caroline South was anchored off Clacton, and Caroline North off the Isle of Man. Radio 390 broadcast light music and drama from an old army fort on Red Sands in the Thames estuary. In September 1964, Radio City had started broadcasting from another Second World War Army fort at Shivering Sands. And an ex-Navy fort, Knock John, supported Radio Essex. Earlier that year, Radio Scotland had begun broadcasting from a converted lightship off Dunbar. And Radio 270 was a service for the North East.
Wonderful Radio London!
The most American sounding of these was Radio London, better known as Big L.
Good afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, guys and gals, little ones and kittens, this is the Stew Pot Show with Mike Lennox from now until 6 o'clock. We're going to have a good time. It's a rave-up afternoon. Watch out now for the number five sound from the Big L Fabulous Whatty.
Everyone seemed to have an opinion on the pirates.
Here comes the bride of shotgun wedding.
I listened to the pirates occasionally myself. His background, as audible wallpaper, as they say, well, they're all right, but I think one's taste really goes beyond that.
People are standing all around.
In our daily business, we have to deal with a very large number of people whose liability to pay our fees is undoubted, but who do their best to evade us. It was therefore very refreshing indeed to find people, businessmen, whose legal liability was of the slimmest, who came forward voluntarily and said they wished to pay our fees. In short, from our point of view, they are very gentlemanly pirates.